For some, magnets are just things that hold the family photos and to-do lists of a fridge door. But in reality, magnets and magnetism make the world go around. Magnets are everywhere. Every electric motor, generator, loudspeaker, mechanical hard drive, microwave oven, and of course, equipment like MRI machines, which I recently found myself in, and which was the inspiration for this video. Magnets are also the fundamental feature of the new fusion reactors, which will hopefully lead us to a clean energy world, which follows on nicely from our last video about the Three Mile Island nuclear incident. So in this video, we'll look at how magnets are an often overlooked but fundamental part of our modern world. This video is sponsored by Magellan TV. Magellan is a new documentary streaming service run by filmmakers that have a passion for their work. Magellan believes that spreading knowledge about human endeavours is key, and their mission is to tell great stories and show how we got to where we are today. With over 3,000 documentaries available and more being added all the time, and a wide selection of those being in 4K, Magellan is a place to find a huge range of documentaries ready to stream directly to your viewing device, be that fixed or mobile. As our video today is about the most powerful magnets in the world, there are some which we haven't mentioned, and these are the ones used by maglev trains. But Magellan has a video called Fast Track, which looks at high-speed rail both now and in the future, which includes our attempts with magnetic levitation to make the fastest trains in the world. You can watch this and many more by getting your 1 month free trial using the link for this special offer right at the top of the description below, and I'm sure you'll enjoy watching Magellan TV as much as I have. Although this video is about magnets, it's as much to do about magnetic fields, because a magnet is just an object or device that creates a magnetic field, and it's how we use those fields that makes them so very, very useful. Magnetic fields are everywhere. The biggest, nearest one is generated by the biggest magnet, the Earth itself, or to be more precise, the ever-moving molten core at the centre of the Earth, right under our feet. But even though the magnetic field that this creates extends for tens of thousands of kilometres into space and protects us from the charged particle radiation given off by the Sun, the power of that field is very weak on a local scale. It only has enough strength to move a pointer of a compass and can be easily overwhelmed by a tiny magnet nearby. So, what is magnetism and what makes a magnet? Well, magnetism is defined as the force generated in matter by the motion of electrons within its atoms. Magnetism and electricity are two aspects of electromagnetism, which is one of the fundamental forces of the universe. Magnetism is the force that is created by the orbit of electrons around the nucleus of an atom, a bit like the planets orbiting the Sun, and the spin of these electrons themselves, which is also like the Earth spinning on its axis. In most elements, there are pairs of electrons spinning in opposite directions, which cancels this force out. However, in some so-called transition metals, such as iron, cobalt, and nickel, and rare earth elements, cerium, neodymium, samarium, and europium, there are single unpaired electrons, and here the forces are not cancelled out, making the electrons like tiny magnets. When there are large groups of these electrons all spinning in the same direction, the magnetic force is added together, creating magnetic domains. And when there are a lot of these magnetic domains in a metal, it's said to be magnetic. These create magnetic field lines in the space around it, and the more field lines there are, the stronger the magnet is, and this is measured in Gauss and Teslas, one Tesla being 10,000 Gauss. A typical fridge magnet at its surface is about 100 Gauss, and the Earth's magnetic field is about 0.5 Gauss. Because electricity and magnetism are intimately linked, when a current is passed through a conductor, like a piece of copper wire, the movement of the electrons in the wire creates a magnetic field around the conductor. But unlike natural permanent magnets, this field only exists for as long as the current is flowing. And the greater the amount of current flow, the greater the magnetic field, and these are known as electromagnets. The power required for an electromagnet is the square of a magnetic field. So to go from 1 Tesla to 10 Tesla requires 100 times the power. But just using copper wire, there is a limit to how much current can flow. And as the wire heats up, its resistance increases, decreasing the current. However, if a superconducting material is mixed with the copper wire, then the amount of current can be much larger and the magnetic field generated can be much stronger. But most superconductors only work when cryogenically frozen as low as minus 269 degrees Celsius, limiting where they can be used. Until relatively recently, most permanent magnets were made from alloys of iron, nickel, and cobalt. But in 1984, both General Motors and Japanese company Sumitomo Special Metals individually developed neodymium magnets, but using different manufacturing techniques. These are now the most powerful commercially available permanent magnets. This is because neodymium has 4 unpaired electrons to the 3 of iron and is capable of storing much more magnetic energy, typically 18 times that of a normal ferrite magnets by volume and 12 times by mass. This means that they can lift up thousands of times their own mass and have become commonplace in things like high power motors of all sizes. Couple that with high energy density lithium ion batteries and you have devices like lithium powered handheld tools that 30 years ago would have needed to be powered by the mains, and tiny high power motors for things like drones and of course new powerful electric motors for electric vehicles. But as powerful as neodymium magnets are, there are some issues. Firstly, when they are heated beyond 100 degrees Celsius, the magnetic energy density drops off dramatically until they reach what is called the Curie point, where they permanently lose all their magnetic ability, though dysprosium or terbium can be added to mitigate this, so they can work at higher temperatures. The second is the supply of these rare earth elements, which is limited to just a few places around the globe and is mostly concentrated in China, which dominates the supply chain, which also limits the competition and keeps the price artificially high. Now, when we get to MRI machines or magnetic resonance imaging scanners, which I happen to have been in one last year, these need to generate a very powerful but very even magnetic field. This is used to align the spin of electrons in hydrogen atoms, and as our bodies are 70% water, which is 2 hydrogen atoms to 1 of oxygen, this works very well to differentiate between fat, water, muscle, and other soft tissue and bone. Around the core of the MRI scanner, other electromagnetic gradient coils then change that field in a rapid but controlled manner, whilst radio waves are injected that affect the spin of the electrons. When the radio waves are turned off, the electrons return to their normal spin, and this is picked up by other receiving coils. And using this information, the computer can build up a 3D image of the body in slices. The main electromagnet uses superconductors which have to be cooled with liquid helium to minus 269 degrees Celsius or 4.2 degrees Kelvin to generate a field strength of about 3 Tesla, which is why you cannot enter the room whilst it's on, wearing or carrying anything made from ferrous metals or have any electronic devices like pacemakers, as these could be dislodged or heated up by the very strong magnetic field. There have been very rare incidents where safety protocols have not been followed, where the MRI magnets have sucked in hospital beds, screwdrivers, oxygen tanks, chairs, and other metal objects into the core of a machine. Now, as powerful as MRI magnets are, they are far from the largest magnets. That accolade will go to the experimental ITER fusion reactor currently being built in France by an international consortium. This is the largest experimental fusion reactor to date and hopefully will prove that fusion is viable on a commercial scale, even though it won't generate any electrical power. The heat created will just be vented to the atmosphere via a giant heat exchanger. Now, if you're wondering why this is such a big deal, then a quick explanation will show you why. Existing nuclear power stations use nuclear fission, which takes heavy elements like uranium and bombards them with neutrons. This splits the uranium atoms and in the process releases more neutrons, some of which heats up the cooling water which surrounds the uranium fuel rods, which is then used to create steam to power turbines to make electricity. The problem with fission is that once a fission reaction takes place, if things go wrong, it can very quickly escalate out of control with disastrous results. That's what happened at Three Mile Island, Chernobyl and Fukushima. It also creates other highly radioactive elements, which are the waste products and will remain radioactive for hundreds or thousands of years. Nuclear fusion, on the other hand, is the same process the Sun and all stars use to convert the lightest element in the universe, hydrogen, into helium. It does this under extreme pressure at the centre of the Sun that fuses the hydrogen nuclei together to create heavier elements like helium. In the process, it releases energy, which we can then capture and use to make electricity. Fusion reactions release 4 times the amount of power compared to fission and 4 million times that of burning coal. Just 1 gram of deuterium-tritium, isotopes of hydrogen, in a fusion process would produce 90,000 kilowatt hours of energy, or the same as burning 11 tons of coal. Fusion is also inherently safe. Unlike fission, it's very difficult to start and maintain, so it cannot create runaway reactions. If anything goes wrong with the process, the reactions stop automatically, and there's no nuclear waste other than the irradiated reaction containment vessels when the plant is shut down or refurbished. The problem is that, unlike the Sun, we cannot recreate the extreme pressure here on Earth. At the centre of the Sun, the density of hydrogen, the lightest element in the universe, is 70 times denser than steel. But fusion can occur on Earth at just 10 times atmospheric pressure if the temperature is high enough, about 10 times hotter than the centre of the Sun, or 150 million degrees Celsius. Now, there is nothing here on Earth or in the universe that can withstand that kind of temperature. But lucky for us, matter at that higher temperature is a plasma, and plasma reacts to magnetic fields. So, if you have a very strong magnetic field, you can contain this super hot plasma, and that's exactly what they do in a tokamak fusion reactor. But using deuterium and tritium as fuel instead of the normal hydrogen, because they react better under less extreme conditions. ITER, or the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, is a magnetic containment fusion reactor and will be the biggest tokamak reactor built so far, and the magnets used in it are also the biggest yet built. The reactor itself is like a large torus shape, a bit like a giant donut, and will use 4 types of superconducting magnets: a central solenoid magnet, aplodial magnets, 18 toroidal field coil magnets, and correction coils. The central solenoid alone is the biggest at 18 metres high, 4.3 metres wide, and weighs in at 1,000 tonnes. Together, these create an intense magnetic field between 11 and 13 Tesla that will hold the plasma in a vacuum in the centre of the reactor vessel, away from the walls, whilst it's heated to 150 million degrees by passing huge electrical currents through the plasma and also bombarding it with X-rays. The central solenoid magnet is made up of 6 sections stacked on top of each other. The combined magnets will produce a field strength of 13 Tesla, which is about 280,000 times stronger than the Earth. These will repel each other when running, so they need to be held together with massive tie rods, which apply 50,000 tons of compression. So great is the magnetic field. In fact, when the central solenoid is active, it could pick up the equivalent of an America-class amphibious assault ship weighing in at 45,000 tons. The 18 TF coils, which surround the ring of the torus, generate a force of up to 40,000 tons of pressure when active. In fact, the whole structure has to withstand forces greater than twice that of the space shuttle at takeoff. Whilst all this is going on, the temperature of a plasma is 150 million degrees, but just a metre or so away, the whole vacuum vessel structure and the superconducting magnets sit in a giant cryostack tank that cools it to minus 269 degrees Celsius. ITER will require 300 megawatts of electrical power to get the plasma to absorb 50 megawatts of thermal power in order to release 500 megawatts of heat in periods of 400 to 500 seconds, when it's finally up and running, hopefully by 2035. However, if you could make the magnets not only more powerful, but use less power and work at higher temperatures, then the whole fusion process would be much more efficient and make even more power for its size. So to this end, the most powerful superconducting magnet ever made has been built and tested by a joint team from MIT and Commonwealth Fusion Systems. By using a new high-temperature superconducting material, it allowed them to make a record-breaking magnetic field of 20 Tesla in September 2021, in a much smaller space, some 40 times smaller than current low-temperature superconducting coils, making net power from fusion possible, possibly even more quickly. The fusion power produced in a tokamak is proportional to the strength of a magnetic field, to the fourth power. So, if you double the magnetic field strength, you can get a 16 times increase in the amount of fusion power. These new coils will be used in the Spark Fusion project, which by 2025 is hoping to produce net positive fusion in the smaller, more easily manufactured reactors. That can't come fast enough if we are to move to a net zero carbon world anytime soon. So I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, then please thumbs up, subscribe and share, and don't forget that Patreon supporters get ad-free versions of the videos before they're released on YouTube.